quite a video game industry, and thus cybersecurity, chief cybersecurity officer, and we create fun. A bit about myself. Let's say I'm a more attached savvy person, so I hope I will be able to catch up with all of you who will be interested and answer your technical questions, both cybersecurity field, cybersecurity related, and game industry related. A bit about company. Yesterday during a discussion with you, I realized that most of you doesn't play games. Neither me, let's say. But yes, we was one of the pioneers in game industry from 97 in Germany. Now headquarters located in Frankfurt. And we created some franchises like Crysis, Far Cry, and many other third-person shooters. For example, Warface, and which is in Guinness Book record for most simultaneous connections at once, and daily active users, and Calm, our current AAA project, flagship project, which we created for PC platform and for Microsoft Xbox, and now late fall will be released with Sony. Also, we manage our own, completely own game engine, CryEngine. It was version 3 was sold to Amazon company, and they created on the base of that old CryEngine, they created a cloud CryEngine called Lumberyard. But still, this is one of the flagship projects, and could be only compared, in my opinion, to Unreal Engine. So there is Unity, but the Unity is still for smaller projects. It's a small showcase of companies, and I've discussed this with Michael, that I had a video that to show a showcase. Small showcase of the engine itself. No HD? Guys, could you help me because this is not intended. I'm sure that I didn't touch. Some of areas in which OpenNebula solution is still either underestimated or completely doesn't use. It's related completely to gaming in cloud and projects like CryEngine in cloud, which right now in investigation and development, and projects like Google Stadia. May I turn on? This will be shared by you, with you by Michael, I think, or on OpenNebula website. But a small addition that CryEngine is completely available on GitHub, all source code, so you can dig in and check all header files, all libraries, everything related, and check how technologies work, and even maybe in advance this would be beneficial to connect the game agent as a service with cloud solutions like Open Network. Because right now the tendency in the game industry is that all use so-called launchers for game engines and games. Every company tried to move from out from Flash because most UI created on Flash, and right now we'll use HTML5 with JavaScript, and it's basically a Chrome browser. Yes, and it's perfect to integrate with cloud, and not only in terms of game preparation when you render the project or game models from within the engine itself, but also to run a whole game, or at least when you test something. So, the game approaches. Most of games said they are a fan of Linux, but mostly everyone works in Windows and create in Visual Studio because it's faster and it's cost effective, and games created in .NET. And there is two bit different approaches to run these executable files. It's madness when you check the process list on servers, for example, on a bunch of servers, and you see the Mono and the exe files in Linux running. But there is Mono and .NET Core, Mono by created by Miguel de Casa, and .NET Core created by Microsoft. It's different and works different comparing in terms of approaches and number of players, but still. And also I put an important flag because it's completely, let's say, different, use completely different approach working with CPU hardware kernels. So we use .NET Core for games and trying to minimize attack surface from the beginning on planning, project planning and architecture stage, and use various technologies like IntelliTrace and other stuff from Microsoft, and not only Microsoft, for some tests I will show another stuff, but white box unit testing is also by our used by our architect team, and I'm proud that Wall Overflow from 15, I think just from 15, it's going through internal computer emergency response team. So all stuff should be greenlighted by security response team. We had combined, we have CERT, which was started from internal product security team, later evolved to CERT. And security operations center, network operations center, working 24/7. And slowly coming to showcase. So what's behind the game? Game, let's say as any other project, is even somehow sometimes more complicated than let's say some application running in product as service or in own cloud, private cloud, because we also need to harden data, not only in terms of GDPR but also in terms of users who paid you money, yes, and let's say we have malicious users, and as usual, is when you, let's say, die in game, yes, you could be disgruntled due to that. And you tend to create or pay for denial of service attack, you create bots which try to disturb a service or the environment or even the center infrastructure. We have such examples. So, Linux server operating system standardization, we use mostly Ubuntu Linux, it's LTS versions, because it's easier to manage standard infrastructure. Own repositories, I'm sure that everyone uses this with additional signatures and package standardization phases that are coming from our own QA departments and tested for each build. And all the updates in these packages are tied to general update windows that are used to, I mean, weekly update Windows. LVM, full disk encryption, we discussed this during coffee, and other stuff like kernel network stack tuning, both kernel space and user space stuff. We have own patch set because of we had a big amount of programmers that could do this. So this stuff I really encourage you to read about. It's alternative versions of schedulers. We use patch sets for both input-output schedulers and both for processes, process schedulers, because usually standard behavior is not works well. The funny thing with mitigation of common vulnerabilities, because the more and more stuff goes exploited, like starting from UEFI and operating system signatures and the mitigation of popular vulnerabilities like Spectre Meltdown, which applies to kernel and kernel stack via, for example, GCC, special GCC flags, GNU compiler collection flags. But the fun stuff is that many protections are incompatible with each other. And for example, right now Canonical stated that they compiled the whole new Ubuntu with stack clash protection, but in real life they confirmed that it's not applied to kernel, QVM, libc, and other stuff, which is essential for this protection because it's incompatible with mind direct branching. So, for example, they decided to stay with protection only for Spectre and Meltdown and neglect completely a stack flash protection. Neither they stated it officially, but it's not true. You can check this by yourself, digging into packages. Be careful. So, user space the same. This the stuff that you need to choose because apart from Linux Tomoyo is incompatible. It's the examples of mandatory access control systems that used on server, not only, I'm not talking about desktop, only on servers, and usually users turn off completely this stuff and okay, I'll move faster. So this is stuff we used for monitoring, so it's pretty a big amount of stuff both tied to game itself and other statistical data and analytical data that we use to make game better. So hardware net capacity tracking, mostly we try to use open source projects and where applicable we try to give back not only in donations, money donations, but also code donations. And by the way, Open Nebula has a beautiful small project called Mini One. I strongly encourage you to test, and if you don't test it, it's a project, small shell script that creates a virtual environment on one server. Just share with your friends so they can try and see how beautiful this idea and try to get more users to project. Own speed test based on Perfsonar and the NDD project. Compliance with security technical implementation guides, NIST special publication sections, we also contribute there. And SCAP, OpenSCAP, still works with Ubuntu with some tuning, but was initially created for Red Hat-based operating systems. Access uses only keys and free pass centralized servers tied up to regions. So we don't use passwords. Normally you should use it. Security is related to CERT itself and security operation centers. You can ask why there's some stuff like WASOC, for example, and RedLK is similar stuff, but WASOC is more about compliance-related stuff, and RedLK is more for red teaming. Google Rapid Response Framework is when, for example, we receive indicators of compromise, so we could capture memory and for further investigation. So I will skip this because this is not enough time. It's network related stuff. It's DNS script. It's mandatory on TopNG to capture and malicious traffic. At least try to capture, because not always specially modified kernel network drivers allow this to interfere, for example, uplink equipment and have some problems with this. Isaac, you may ask how the big amount of data transferred across all regions. We use torrent, so we use own implementation of torrent tracker, and all traffic we have updates of 10 gigabytes, for example, and these 10 gigabytes should be propagated to 500 servers at once for one region, for example, only for USA. In Europe we have triple more. This is all propagated via torrent. This is data center API. How it should be, how you could use it. So basic Python with Flask, and you will have something you can play with that. So some unusual ways, it's madness, but yes, Metasploit is still applicable, and to understand how this works. This is, you can read this from presentation later, but this is how we verify data center and our partner data centers, and typical reports for each data center we await is very big. So definitely our architects move to data center and check everything related to this stuff. Locations. this is a small slide that was, I want to mention the company called Packet. Good friends for OpenNebula, I think sadly no one from them right now here, but they've worked as a good and stable backbone for us, giving us the possibility to use OpenNebula and disaggregated data centers with hardware bare metal, not like Amazon, but hardware bare metal, which allows to use real cores and skip. Right now we use, for example, in each data center we have from two to four racks filled up with servers that shut them down, called cold racks. It's fully prepared servers, and for example, in case of unpredicted load, we can turn on, or in case of emergency, this is four racks, because typical data center can't give you send big amount of servers like this, but Packet can. So, why the OpenNebula disaggregated data center feature is beneficial? Because it completely eliminates scalability problems. Like with Packet, you can either use currently available resources to fire up more servers, or you can, if in case you have a planned event, like for example Christmas event or some event in 1 month, you can call them and tell them, guys, we will need such amount of servers, be prepared please, and you will pay only for that you are using. So OpenNebula with IPAM and one provision allows you to use it. Human configuration errors are completely eliminated, because and combined with time save, you may ask, why not Ansible or another automation system? Because you save time, and business want to save time and achieve more money, because in case of automation system, we still use this, but you need to fire up servers, you need to pre-configure, you need to send data, propagate data using torrents. But in case of OpenNebula, you can just send a whole pre-configured image via torrent to the servers. So everything done, IPsec encrypted tunnels configured, and we'll fire up and start to one connect back. So it's about scalability types. Predictable scalability is not possible, to be honest, in most cases. So every company has its own formulas, mass formulas to calculate this, to calculate workflow, but mixed domains regarding scalability, or updates when you need to swap servers between each other to exclude the downtime. This is about fast growth. So it's, guys, I put your slide. So it's pretty straightforward. I'm sure that right now it's at least I know from our side that it's more stable right now. And big thanks to guys from OpenNebula because they helped a lot working with Drytek to make this possible. And I believe that Crytek was the first company from the industry that uses such kind of solution. It's completely different from Amazon, so only a few images, so it's one single deployment script combining together all stuff and creating and deploying region nodes. So this is a task to one provision. Each provision, for example, could be related to its own region, geo region, and each task combines itself servers, networks, and other stuff, including connect back to head of OpenNebula servers and propagating of pre-configured image separating system. This one related to hosts in region started from one provision task. And this one is VM lists already running with pre-configured network in tied up to head server. Thank you. And guys, I'm sorry, but let's first clap hands to guys from OpenNebula because it's so.